حبيتك والشوق انقالوا ليلات الحلوة عالبال
حبيتك والشوق انقالوا ليلات الحلوة عالبال
خلي الليل يعاتب ليل وموالي زرح موال
حبيتك والشوق انقالوا ليلات الحلوة عالبال
وخلي القلب يقول القلب رفقة نحن ووحدة حال
حبيتك والشوق انقالوا ليلات الحلوة عالبال
حبيتك وسع الغابات اللي حدود حدود اللفتات
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 وسع الغيم بصبحياتي رح الخلفة لالتلال
حبيتك والشوق قالوا ليلات الحلوة عالبال
Good evening, everyone. I think we'll get started as we see a few more people trickling in. I just gonna do a little double check to make sure I'm not muted because that, you know, that is the mantra of the past year is you are on mute. So welcome to a very special evening of the X Page. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Pam Patel, and I am the artistic director of Empty Space, as well as the theater facilitator for the X Page. Before we begin, I want to acknowledge that we, the participants and the facilitators of this project, are tuning into you from the Haldimand Tract, which is Six Nations territory, traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and Neutral peoples, also known as Waterloo Region. And as we acknowledge the land that we're on, I also want to acknowledge that doing a land acknowledgement is not enough. In fact, it's really just the beginning, and there is a lot of work that needs to be done, especially as we discover the stolen children at residential schools across this country and take a cold, hard look at the history of Canada, a history and a truth that Indigenous peoples of this land have known for a very long time. I think about how I come from an immigrant family and how over the past several weeks, I engaged in discussion with my parents about these discoveries that are being made, about how this makes us reflect on our own histories, experiences, and relationships with colonization and occupation, and how we have added responsibilities now as settlers of this land, what it means to truly stand in solidarity with Indigenous communities and recognize the dichotomies of oppression and privilege that exist within our immigrant and newcomer bodies. I encourage you all to consider this in yourselves as well and in your own histories and not shy away from the difficult conversations because they are so necessary and so needed. And the stories you hear tonight are also very necessary and so needed. Stories from women who now consider this land their home and were brought here from a myriad of reasons and contexts. Suffice it to say, everything is interconnected. So tonight will take us on a journey through family, migration, revolution, and the little things that make life memorable and beautiful. So at this point, I'd like to invite my X-Page colleagues to the virtual stage to introduce themselves and talk more about this project.
Hi, my name's Carrie Snyder. And in 2019, I co-founded the X-Page workshop with Dr. Lamise Elathari. And this season, I am the program coordinator, and I also was an editor on some stories.
Hello, I'm Pamela Malloy, and I'm an editor on the X Page project.
Hi, I'm an Andy Carroll Woolery, and I'm an editor with the X Page project, as well as a mentor, and I was also a participant in the 2020 X Page.
Hi, my name is Maha Eid. I'm the project assistant program coordinator, and I was a participant in the first season of the X Page 2 years ago.
Hi, everyone. I'm Smeyra Nurkan. I'm the peer mentor for the XPage workshop. I was also a former participant in 2019.
Hi, my name's Emily Bednarz, and I'm the administrative assistant for the workshop.
Hi, everyone. My name is Taranima Mittal, and I'm the resident artist for the XPage this season.
Hi, I'm Melissa Durrell, and I'm the vocal coach for XPage.
Hi, I'm Bronwyn Blakely. I work for MT Space, and I'm helping with the tech tonight.
Hi, I'm Tasneem Jamal, and I'm the writing coach of the XPage workshop. The workshop was established in 2019 to provide a platform for immigrant and refugee women in Waterloo Region to share their stories and to provide the public with a deeper understanding of the lives they left behind and the journeys they undertook to find a place for themselves here in our community. As each week brought new challenges and new accomplishments, we learned about their trials and experiences. We also witnessed the blossoming of friendships as the women found ways to encourage and support each other throughout the process. We are grateful for their enthusiasm, their persistence, and their courage.
So I'll just jump in with a few housekeeping notes. At this time, you will notice that the chat has been deactivated. And this is so that the performers can focus on their performances. We can't see or hear you. So if you do need to get up and move around, please feel free to do so. And in fact, I would encourage you to make yourselves comfortable, even grab a snack or dinner, and just sit back for the show. If at any point though, you are having technical issues or you have a question, or you just want to congratulate a performer, you can send that note through the Q&A function, which I will be monitoring throughout the performance, and I can pass along your positive feedback to the virtual backstage. We're also offering closed captioning through an automated system, which isn't quite perfect, but if you did miss something in the performances, all of the stories are going to be published online, and I encourage you to follow the X page so you can read the published version of all the stories throughout the summer. And I will say this is a live performance. Everything you see tonight is live, except for one of the stories, which was pre-recorded. So we're embracing all the technical glitches, twitches, and home disruptions that come with Zoom. And I invite you on this ride with us. So at this point, I'm going to pass it over to Carrie.
The XPage workshop builds and develops stories using a writing exercise based on the teachings of Linda Berry. And we like to say that an XPage is the opposite of a blank page. It's a space where we can enter into an image or a memory using all of our senses. So tonight, we invite you into the XPage. Welcome to our performance of Little Things.
The story I'm about to tell happened in the biggest train station of Beijing, China. In the middle of the central hall, I was sitting on top of some newspapers that I found beside a garbage can, wiping my tears away. It felt like there was a million people here. People were busy running around. No one was paying attention to me. I kept my eyes fixed on the two huge entrance doors so that I would not miss anyone coming through. The train I was supposed to be on left 30 minutes ago. Despite the ditching the cab, which was stuck in the traffic, running 6 blocks on foot to catch up, and then begging the staff to let me on the train, I missed it. This was my first business trip on my very first job. I couldn't afford any mistakes. Quickly, I made plan B. The best and only option I had was to buy a standing ticket on another train. Standing for 14 hours trip would be rough. but I need to get through this. I went over to the ticket window. There was a swarm of people gathered around there. Arms in hand was reaching out from every direction. I felt like a little boat taken by a big wave of human bodies. More people were piling up behind me, pushing me forward. But there's no space forward, only a solid human wall. I was squished. I couldn't breathe. There was no air left in my body. I was about to pass out. Help! I cried out. Someone heard me and helped me out. I ran out of ideas. I don't know what to do. So I called my family. After I explained everything, my dad gave me a short and firm instruction. Stay where you are and wait for me. Dad's voice has always been strong and reassuring, with a unique power to calm me down. I did as he said. Here's me sitting on the newspapers and staring at the entrance door, hoping for a miracle. The door all of a sudden pushed open. It was dark outside, but I could see a familiar figure. It was a tall, strong man wearing a black windbreaker and a black hat. His face was in the shadow, but I knew right away. It was my dad. He paused for a second, eyes locked on me, and walked towards me with a powerful stride. At that very moment, everything turned into slow motion. The loud noise around me seemed very far away. All I heard were his steps. I saw him coming towards me. The wind lifted his windbreaker like a black cape flying behind him. Step by step, he came closer and closer, like a savior. He stopped in front of me, bent down, and reached out his hand to me. My dad somehow happened to be on a business trip on the same day and to the exactly same city. And one of his colleagues couldn't make it, so he has one extra first class ticket. I had my own room, bed, TV, and room services. After a good night's sleep, I arrived at the destination with full energy. I even tagged along with their welcome party until I had to leave for my work conference. It was like having a five-star vacation. My nightmare turned into the sweetest dream. A few years later, I left my family and come to Canada alone. To survive, I had to grow strong. I become tough. There was no time to cry. There's no one to ask for help. The story has become my dearest memory of a time when someone was there who I could lean on and who could magically solve everything for me. Sometimes when I'm tired, I wish I could just make a phone call. And my dad would appear from the sky like he did at night in the train station, like a superhero, and save me.
Why do you have to be an English guy? I angrily said this to my dad the second I got into the car. My dad isn't an English. He's actually Iraqi. So I should explain why I said this to him. In my culture, an English person is someone who's always on time and sticks to the schedule. People in my culture are usually relaxed about time. But my dad was precise and wanted everything to be on schedule. We were a family of four women. as the only guy, if we were heading to an event, he would be the first one ready and kept reminding us to hurry up and be on time, which was kind of impossible. On this day, when I was only 16 years old, I had been at my friend's birthday party. It was an amazing party. I met a lot of my friends there, and we were having so much fun that I didn't notice the time. Suddenly, the doorbell rang. I knew it. It was my father, even before my friend's mom came and said, "Lena, it's your dad." The invitation said the party was supposed to end at 7 p.m. And it was 7 p.m. now, but the party wasn't over. This is when I got into the car and called my dad an English guy. I can remember it like it was yesterday. The street was dark and I could hear the news from the car radio, which he had to lower it just to listen to me complaining. "What happened? You didn't have fun? Was it a dull party?" "No, it was perfect, but you came early. The party hasn't finished yet. We haven't had the chance to sing to her. And the most important thing, we haven't eaten the cake." "But I didn't come early. I just came on time." I know they said it will end at 7, but that didn't mean that you have to be here exactly at 7. I was angry, but he answered me in a calm way. He even offered me to wait so I could stay longer. Then I started to feel bad because he was tired and came a long way just to pick me up on time. I know he worked hard and he wanted to go home and rest. "No, I can't do that to you. You are tired. And what will you do here waiting for me?" "Don't worry about me. I will read a book or keep listening to the radio." Looking back now, I know that he was exhausted and he was dreaming to go home and get some rest. But he gave up a nice evening so that I could have fun at a birthday party. I lost my father 26 years ago. At that time, in the car that night, what he did seemed like a small thing. But now, I think maybe he was planning to leave me with a remarkable memory so I could feel his love and share it with you almost 30 years later. I feel ashamed I spoke to my dad this way, but I'm proud that I have a dad like him. And I am sorry that I lost him so early.
My dad is scary. Picture a man who wears a suit and a tie 6 days a week, is always on the phone, usually yelling at someone because they didn't do what they were supposed to. He worked out very early in the morning, went to work, and back after dark about 6 days a week. On Sundays, he wore sweats and didn't start his days as early, but that didn't stop him from going into work. He traveled a lot for work. He was gone almost every 2 weeks for a few days. When I was about 7 years old, my dad started a project in another city. He was overseeing the construction of a skyscraper. The car rides were about 4 hours each way. One evening, my dad, as usual, got home at 7 p.m. after everyone had finished dinner. My parents sat around the dinner table and talked about their day. My siblings and I joined for a bit, but we didn't stay long. I mean, who would want to hang around a scary person? I went into the next room to do my homework. That evening, it was math. It was going well, and then I got stuck. I didn't understand. I remember the teacher earlier that day explaining the concept, piquer, crochet, interval, piquer, crochet, interval. The words kept playing in my head like a broken record. Looking back, it seems easy now, but then, yeah, it didn't make much sense to me. I thought of my dad in the next room. I probably should have been scared to bother him,
But I guess I didn't think much of it. I was about 7 years old and really wanted to make sense of this math. I walked up to him with my textbook and asked him to walk me through it. He was squinting, trying to read my textbook. Watching him, I thought it was both funny and intriguing. Tu ne vois pas? You can't see? I remember asking him as I watched attentively. He didn't answer. He took his time and used different approaches to explain it. He drew on pieces of paper. That didn't work. He pointed to tiles on the floor, but he kept saying the same thing as my teacher. Tu as deux piquets? L'espace entre les deux, c'est un intervalle. I was determined to get it, so I kept asking more and more questions. My dad got up, went into his bedroom, and came back wearing his glasses. All of a sudden, something changed. He was more alert. That's when I realized he really needed them to see. Up till then, I didn't really understand how bad his prescription was or that he absolutely needed them to see properly. In that instant, he became a bit less scary to me, less powerful in a way, and more of a human who, like everyone else, wasn't perfect, had flaws. I kept asking questions until I was able to understand the concept and do my assignment. To this day, my dad reminds me about my perseverance. But this story also reminds me about how attentive and loving he is. Even though he'd had a long day and a hard time reading, he was willing to help and put his needs aside to listen and help to the best of his ability. After I discovered this about my dad, something changed in both of us that my siblings hadn't quite figured out yet. From that moment, whenever they wanted something from my dad, they would push me into his room and have me ask them for it, even though I was the youngest. But I got smart. I'd walk up to him and get his attention and say, Papa, oui, he'd respond turning around. I'd point to my sibling and say, il veut te dire quelque chose. They want to ask you something. We'd look at each other and laugh because he immediately would get what was going on.
I could barely catch my breath. Between the uncontrollable laughter and the quirky jerks, my attempts at efficient breathing were futile. Blankets with animal and floral prints were scattered all over the place in the most unflattering arrangement. Every item of our living room was placed where it was not supposed to be. With no regard to interior design or our mom's efforts in tidying up the house, we had declared our living room a blanket fort. My siblings and I were creating a joyous chaos and a mother's nightmare way past our bedtime. Our exuberance concealed the noise of the howling wind angrily slamming at our bedroom windows. We felt rebellious and unbothered. Suddenly, we heard footsteps. As they were approaching, we retreated to our fort and hid under the zebra blanket. The roars of the wind outside grew louder. Delighted, it seemed, at the prospect of us getting in trouble. Silent with anticipation, patient, like soldiers in the face of an impending doom. We waited. It was Dad. As he was sweeping the living room with his eyes, I could hear my heart beating in my eardrums. Finally, his eyes landed on us with a decisive stare. After a second that felt like an eternity, he smiled. Then we knew he was joining us against the unjust bedtime curfews. In that moment, the warmth stopped coming from the propane heater and started radiating from his face. Baba embraced me and seated me on his lap. Quickly, my siblings deployed themselves in front of us. Whatever Baba was saying was making us burst into laughter. One of my brothers was laughing so much, he started clapping his hands like a seal. Now, my dad is not a comedian. I don't think I've ever heard him tell a joke. We were laughing because Baba was speaking French to us, a language that was so foreign to our ears. Now, why would French be funny? It is not. In fact, it is a very sexy language. It is the language of love. We didn't know that, of course. The language of love was ice cream instead of vegetables, or of course, staying up past our bedtime. I think our laughter was that which accompanies wonder and awe. We saw a side of our father that we had not seen before, and it tickled our souls. What I feel for my father is a raw, unfiltered, an aggressive form of love that can easily overwhelm me when I speak of it. My soul is intertwined with his. Some time ago, my dad and I had a barren disagreement. It was the first and the last disagreement I would ever allow myself to be in with him. I was sobbing when he walked into my room, sat at the edge of my bed, pointed at his heart with tears in his eyes and said, "Come, cry here." A couple of months ago, this heart that has hosted me between its chambers for 24 years was tired, and Baba had to undergo open heart surgery. When I spoke with the surgeon, I warned him that he would be responsible for two hearts in the OR, that I would become homeless if anything went wrong. Anyway, the wind kept howling at our windows, demanding to be let in. I asked Baba to say more things in French. Willingly, yielding to my nagging, Baba said, "Vous êtes ma reine. You are my queen." I felt the blood rushing into my cheeks, so I buried my face in his neck. There, in the stubbles of his beard, my memory ends. Today I'm learning French. I called my dad and started parroting some phrases I had practiced. "Salut, je m'appelle Hiba. Je suis Palestinienne, je travaille au Canada et j'habite à Waterloo." On that phone call, my dad started laughing. He commented on my accent and he said that he already knew that my name is Hiba and that I live in Canada. So I said, "Tu es mon roi. You are my king."
I'm there in the car with my dad and my sister. Her name is Hadil. A very beautiful sunny morning with a delicate breeze. I'm 6 years old in grade one. It's the first day of school. We've moved to a different area that is far away from our previous home. Therefore, we have switched school and get ready to meet new friends and a new world. At my old school, I had a friend. Her name is Inas, who I loved a lot and did not want to be apart from. I'm nervous and silent when being introduced to new friends. I'm wearing a new school uniform. It's gray and white. Though we registered with the bus service, however, Dad wanted to make sure to drive us the first and second day to ensure we feel safe and comfortable. My sister Hadil is sitting beside me in the back seat. She's older than me in fourth grade. She's coping well with the idea of moving to a new school. She didn't like our old school anyway. She did not like the fact that they didn't offer any music sports classes. We usually talk and exchange some morning laughs and jokes while in the car with Dad. But on this day, I'm quiet, silent, and nervous. Staring in the window all the way through from our new house to our new school. It's 7:30 a.m. My dad is looking into the rear view mirror to check on us in the back seat. I see his eyes in the mirror. He can feel how stressed I am. Here we are, arriving at the school entrance. Children and parents seem very excited. It's very packed at the parking lot. Dad helps put on my backpack and water bottle, but before we head to the school door, Baba notices my teary eyes. I look straight into his eyes as if I'm calling out for help. He bends down and ties my shoes laces. He makes sure that the socks are comfy and aligned. He whispers in my ears, "Baba, are your socks tight?" I remain silent. I nod my head for approval. Dad tries to enlarge the socks by stretching them with his gentle hands, smiling and looking at me. "Wait for a second," he says. He opens the car door and finds a pair of white socks that have my favorite prints. He says, "Whenever your socks get tight again, wear the socks. You'll feel better. I promise, Baba." The socks have my favorite decorative small little pearls on them. I feel like a princess when wearing them. I put on the new socks to feel very soft and fancy. When we're seated in the classroom, everyone starts to look at one another with so many questions in their eyes. Everyone wants to feel like they belong. During the break in the green artificial grass next to our classroom, I take off my shoes and put them back on several times. I'm not sure why I feel I have to do this. Maybe I want to show the others that I have brand new socks. Maybe I need to check on my socks to feel that Dad is with me. There were so many loving messages and meanings beyond his words. It was his way to reassure me that new beginnings are not easy, but we can beautify them in our own way. It was his way and unconditional love and care. I'm here after 26 years, and I still remember that Baba was with me every single moment during that day. I love you and I miss you, Baba.
I am 9 years old, and it's Christmas time in Accra. And as kids, we all know what that means. Daddy comes alive at Christmas time. Today, he's playing Bonnie M loudly on the speakers inside and does a little dance, elbows out, swaying from side to side as he makes his way through the kitchen, out the back door, and onto the kitchen porch. Yata tabia, fasa kano breme. He calls out to my sister to bring him the knife. I'm crouched down in the corner of the kitchen porch, and I hide my face between my knees and wrap my hands around my head, making myself as small as I can. Maybe if he can't see me, I won't be invited to the killing this year. It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and the sun is burning hot. But the occasional breeze of the dusty Hamatan winds cools my body and calms my nerves. I wonder if Jeffrey feels it too. He stands about 20 feet in front of me, attached by a rope to a tree in the backyard. Jeffrey continues to chew lazily at some fresh cassava leaves. He has no idea what befalls it, but I do. This year, it's Jeffrey. Last year, it was Afi, the sheep, and the year before, Kuhua, the chicken. They all end up the same way, surrounded by jollof rice, fried plantain, fufu and light soup on the dining table. On the edge of the porch, my sister Abby is perched before two large metal basins. And one of them is hot water, where Jeremy, a large rooster, is immersed. He has already met his fate. My sister is 10, just a year older than me. But at that moment, she seems several years older as she stands before the basins, eyebrows furrowed, working painstakingly as she pulls the feathers off the birds. Her oversized orange polo shirt is creased in perfect squares from when it was neatly folded away. The heart-shaped blood stain in the middle of the shirt is just one of several stains the shirt has gathered over the years. She looks up briefly for a second to smile at my dad as he walks by, wearing his matching orange shirt with blood stains. They save these shirts for the special occasion. I think I have managed to escape being an accomplice to the slaughter of the Christmas goat today. Uncle Didi is digging a hole in the ground to capture the blood from Jeffrey. And to the left, Daddy tends the wood fire that will be used to burn the bits of the goat. I think I should stop calling it Jeffrey now, don't you? I look away as Uncle Didi unties it from the tree and walks it towards the hole he has made in the ground. It's time. And that is my cue. I sneak off to the front of the house and find my friend. Outside, I can still smell the firewood and hear the rhythmic pounding of pestles as neighbors far and near prepare their fufu. My friend and I line up sticks in a row in the middle of the road and stand behind it. First person to the intersection wins. On your mark, get set, go. I sprint from my ready position, confident of my victory before the race even begins. It's 5:30 p.m. and the streetlights are starting to come on. I sneak back into the house and head to the dining room, where my family is starting to gather around the table. I help my grandparents to their seats at the head of the table and hold out a bowl of soapy water for them to wash their hands. I find my seat between my little sisters, Eunice and Crystal, grabbing their hands as we bow our heads to pray. As I open my eyes, Mommy makes her way into the room with a large saucepan. She sets it on the edge of the table and ladles out light soup onto my bowl of fufu. I start to eat, shoving morsels of food down my throat when I suddenly realize that the pieces of meat sitting beautifully inside my soup is Jeffrey, the goat, cut up, spiced, and cooked to perfection. A delicious Christmas meal.
It's 1 a.m. Everything around me is darkness, except for a dim light from the small battery board lamp in the middle of the living room. The light is so dim that I can hardly see the faces of my family, who are all still awake. It's 1 a.m. and they act as if it is 8 p.m. My brother Khalid, as usually, is fighting with my other brother, Muhammad. Khalid thinks his age give him the power to ask Muhammad to bring him whatever he needs. Sarah, my sister, who hates fighting, stand up and sit. Both of you, shut up. I'll bring the bill. My mom is quiet this night. I'm not sure if she is tired or sad. My dad is smoking and serving the Facebook pages. Every 10 minutes, he tells us one of the Facebook jokes, which we all know, but we laugh. It's our dad. We should laugh. Then suddenly, and from nowhere, small hand grabs my cheeks. And Lulu turns my face toward hers and says, Lima, which is close to my actual name, Rima. Lima, what's about making a cake? In less than a second, my mom breaks her silence and says, Lulu, it's too late for a cake. Alma, or as we call her, Lulu, is my youngest sibling with a 20 years gap between me and her. She came to this world as a surprise. She's a gift from God to my family. In one of the largest camps in the world, and in a place like this, which is full of sadness, stories, and tragedies, a little creature who was made from joy was born. She brings all the happiness with her and makes our house laugh again. Because I'm leaving this camp to go to Canada soon, I make a promise to do anything Lulu wants. I want her to remember me, her biggest sister, who loves her more than words can say. And without thinking, I say, yes, let's make a cake. Lulu hugs me and kisses my cheek and starts jumping and yelling, cake, cake, cake. She's happy and I am more. I turn on the flashlight on my phone and holds Lulu's hands to walk to the kitchen. I can see my mom's eyes clearly saying, you will clean that kitchen before you sleep. I bought everything we need on the ground. It will not be a good cake if Lulu does not help. I measure everything using cups. I sit down a big bowl and me and Lulu mash the banana. After that, the little hands start pour the flour and sugar while I stir the mixture. While Lulu is adding the last cup of flour, it drops from her hands and the kitchen floor is covered with the flour. Flour all over our clothes. Lulu looks to me with the crying eyes and says, Asf, Asf. So I hold her little hands. While I am cleaning up, I look to her and say, don't be sorry, that's fine. We will clean it later. Let's finish the cake now. Usually, I may get annoyed about the mess, but these are my last day with Lulu and my family, and I will not let anything bother me. We bought the cake in the oven. After 10 minutes, we smell it. Aromatic, fresh, sweet. I try to see it with the light from my phone, but I cannot. The oven looks dark and nothing is clear. Somehow, this reminds me of my future and my next step. I have no idea how it will be, just like I have no idea if the cake will rise or not. Signing that paper makes it harder for me. How can a piece of paper cause so much pain? I still cannot believe that they will force me to sign that I cannot go back to Jordan. I cannot see my family. I cannot watch Lulu growing up. Why do I have to choose between my family and my dream? What's the right decision? How I can leave my mom? I saw with my own eyes how she spends nights crying for my sister, who left to go to France 9 months ago. And Lulu, how I cannot hug Lulu again. Lima, Lulu says and interrupts my thoughts man. Is the cake ready now? Yes, it is, Lulu. And guess who will take the first bite? She screams, Lulu!
For the past 2 months, I'd been looking forward to the day I'd move to this new house in Kitchener. While I wrapped glasses and plates and other items one by one, I imagine decorating my new house. I imagine sipping tea on the deck while studying. Now I'm here and unwrapping these items. I'm reminded of many of the houses I lived in. This pink metal box reminds me of my house in Turkey. I thought we would be able to return to this house. So I left everything the way I wanted to find it, clean and tidy. But after 6 months from we arrived in Zambia for my husband's business, we sold this house. My mother and siblings packed up our belongings for us with tears in their eyes, because they thought that we wouldn't go back to Turkey. This Turkish tea and coffee cups came with my mother-in-law during a visit to our house in Zambia. One day, in the living room of that house, we had a fun birthday party for our Turkish friend from the university. After this party, we heard on social media that there had been a coup attempt in Turkey on July 15, 2016. We couldn't believe this was true, but still, we decided to cancel our plane tickets to Turkey. We were supporters of the Hizmet movement, and they were blamed for the coup attempt. This was a huge disappointing moment for us. Whenever I use these cups, I feel pain in my heart. My friend in Turkey, who has a glassware store, rubbed these cups one by one so they could reach me in Zambia without any damage. We had a 20-year friendship, but I haven't seen her since 2015 in a farewell meeting. We don't talk on the phone as much as past after this school attempt. This peeling knife reminds me of the house in Turkey I lived in for the first 7 years of my marriage. We lived in the same apartment as three generations with my family and my husband's family. In that home, I tested motherhood twice and experienced life as a wife, housewife, and a student. Although I fell in love with schooling, I had to choose my beliefs or my desires. Because of the government's hijab ban, I decided not to start university after high school. Thanks to God, after getting married and having two toddlers, I had the chance to begin university when I was 26. My family and I were delighted and proud when I graduated at 30. This Hilli Sharif magnet, which expresses our Prophet Muhammad, takes me back to my father's house in Turkey. This house was full of my memories from my childhood, youth, and even early motherhood. The last memory I have of Turkey is in this house. I remember long hugs and tears. My mother cooked a special Turkish pastry called gözleme for breakfast. We spent the day at this house with my aunties, nephews, siblings, and in-laws. However, it wasn't similar to our previous gatherings. It was like a mourning rather than a cheerful meeting. My mother's and sister's eyes were red as they said farewell. It felt like someone was trying to remove my heart from my body. How did all these little things draw me in memories? I believe that küçük şey yoktur. There is no little thing, like the title of the book written by the Turkish author Kemal Urak. All these little things are keeping me connected to the houses that are a part of the story of my short life on this earth.
It was the summer of my 15th birthday, on the third Friday of July. It was the yearly Imamat Day celebration at Al Muhammadiyah School in Al Khawabi area. From the balcony, I could see people gathering at the school for the event. The school is across the river at the bottom of the valley, and our house is in the middle of the mountain. At 4 p.m., it was time for us to go there too. I called my little sister Ula, who was 11 years old at that time, and we headed to my uncle's house to join my cousins. We crossed the road leading to my uncle's house through the village square. The village square was a place of shared joy and sorrow, weddings and funerals. It was where the children of the village played. At the edge of the square, there were two huge oak trees, one that shaded the stairs of my aunt's house, where some of the village elders sat to escape the heat of their houses. The other tree shaded my uncle's house. Between these two trees lay the grave of Sheikh Musa. And between the grave of Sheikh Musa and the village prayer house was my uncle's house. This house is the heart of my small village. It welcomes us when we come to the village. I was wearing a white cotton dress with light purple stripes, and my hair was braided with purple flower knotted at the end. My little sister Ola was wearing a similar dress, but the purple flower was knotted on the side of her short golden hair. Our dresses were made specially for that celebration by the best tailor, my mother. Uncle Shamsuddin welcomed us with his usual smile as he told us that we were more beautiful than the flowers on our heads. I love my Uncle Shamsuddin, and his beautiful words still make me happy. I used to feel a pinch of jealousy for his five children, who have the best father in the world. I love that home. In my memory, I can still see the white walls and the dark green marble floor. I have many memories of the roof of that house with my five cousins. I played in water fight, ate pomegranate and olive salad, sang to Fairuz, and followed my cousin's creative ideas. My uncle and his good wife never complained about our noise. Beyond the entrance, on the right, there were the children's bedrooms. On the left is the salon and the large black library. From that library, my uncle would give me traditional books to read. In front of the library was the dining table where little Ibrahim sat waiting for his usual meal of eggs and milk. In front of the sitting room was a glass terrace overlooking the beautiful valley. On that festival day, from the terrace, I could hear the sounds of cars heading to the great celebration. Many people would gather every year from neighboring villages and from neighboring city to hear the presentation of religious songs and poems. And most importantly, that was our only chance to see our school crushes in the summertime. The celebration venue is a 15-minute walk from our village. But walking in that humid summer afternoon was not comfortable in our fancy clothes. So my uncle took us in his blue Chevrolet pickup. The celebration that year was different for me, as it was my first time participating with the singing group. I remember that I stood before the audience on a high concrete stand and without a microphone. I remember that the place was quiet, with only the voices of eight girls reciting a poem that we still, even to this day, repeat every Saturday night. The sun was hidden behind the mountain, giving us a chance to enjoy a pleasant summer breeze. I remember eyes watching me and my heart beat it hard. I was so shy to ask anyone about their opinion of our performance in the choir, but the praise was not late, especially from my uncle, whose words I had been most eager to hear. That evening at his house, he told me that I was shining like a star in the sky. For 10 years, I have been waiting for the third Friday of July to visit my uncle's house. Maybe if we went, my 15 years old daughter would sit on the blue pickup with other children and go to Al Muhammadiya school to celebrate.
I was 21 years old. I was a student in mechanical engineering in Sharif University of Technology in Tehran, the capital city of Iran. And I was in love. Yes, I was 21 when I fell in love with my professor. He was a professor. He studied electrical engineering, and I was in the math class he lectured, named numerical analysis. After almost 6 months of struggling to get approval from my parents, they were convinced. Or in better words, they gave up. He had absolutely no flaws, not with his personality, job, family, appearance, nothing. He wasn't that tall, but he was handsome with black big eyes and black stylish hair. He had a good sense of humor, which made him and his classes adorable. He was a skilled teacher, but not strict. He was trustworthy, caring, and kind. He had served in the war between Iran and Iraq and became ill from the chemical weapons used against Iranian soldiers. He was one of many victims. I knew that, yet still I couldn't help myself. There's no cure for love. I loved him and accepted him with all those things, even though they would hurt us in the future. I didn't want to think about them. We got engaged. I was walking on clouds with the biggest smile on my face. I had everything I wanted. We were the happiest in the world. 2 weeks after the engagement, he was hospitalized for his illness. I said nothing to my family. I saw no need to cause them worry. I went to visit him in the hospital on a sunny, hot day in early May. On my way there, I stopped by a flower shop to buy a bouquet of flowers. Even in the dim light of the shop, I could see flowers hanging from the walls and ceiling, beautiful baskets everywhere. I looked around and carefully picked a purple iris and two bunches of freesia, white and yellow. When the shop owner was making the bouquet, I noticed that I didn't have enough money. I got nervous. I started to sweat. I prepared an apology in my head to say to the man, "Leave the flowers there." While I was busy trying to think of the least embarrassing way to say I don't have enough money, he said, "These flowers are expensive, but because these two bunches are the last ones, I will give you a discount." I let out a small sigh of relief in my head, but still I was worried. I only hoped I had enough. After a few minutes, he made a beautiful bouquet. I calculated in my head, those two bunches of freesia cost twice the money I had. Plus the virus, I was absolutely sure it wouldn't be enough. Oh my God, what should I do now? How could I tell the man that I don't have enough money with me? I had ordered a bouquet and I had to pay for that anyway. He handed me the finished bouquet. The purple iris sat in the middle, surrounded by a circle of white freesia, and then a circle of yellow, wrapped in a purple paper with a white ribbon. It was stunning. After all those frustrating thoughts and nervous sweating, I asked the price. To my surprise, he told me 1,500 tomans, which was exactly how much I had with me then. I paid the money, hugged the bouquet, and left the flower shop happily. Everybody in the street stared at me and the flowers. It looked like a bouquet of brides. When I got to the hospital, to my spouse's room, he was sleeping. After a few minutes, he woke up and smiled. I laid a gentle kiss on his forehead. I whispered a piece of a poem we loved. I kissed him, and I'm not worried about ending the world anymore. I've got my share. Put the bouquet in his hands. He was surprised and smiled again sweetly. He told me that he was dreaming of a bouquet of flowers which came to him from God. He looked at the flowers and said, "It was this. This is the bouquet of flowers from God."
وقتی گریبانم با دست خلقت می درید وقتی ابد چشم تو را پیش از ازل می آفرید وقتی
Summer. I am 8 years old. I am sitting on the floor of my grandparents' house in Banfield, Buenos Aires, Argentina. It's too hot outside. We just had lunch, so my bon papa is taking a nap on his reclining chair. My bon mama is dozing as she tries to read a magazine. The piano is on my left, but I cannot play it now for obvious reasons. The windows are open, and the sun filters through the grapevines. I can smell grapes smashed in the ground. I can hear the birds chirping outside and the chicharras calling each other. It's quiet inside, but I don't feel like taking a nap. Behind me, on the chimney, is the gun. It's always there, but it still scares me. My bon papa used to be a policeman. He carries a gun when he's out of the house. I guess the gun is also taking a nap. There are more guns inside the house, but I don't want to find them. This one, though, that is hard to miss. It's a cannon, and it's outside in the backyard. It was a gift from my bon papa to my bon mama. She likes to put pots with plants and flowers all around it. I think she's trying to cover it. I like playing on it. I dream that it's a horse that flies and takes me away of scary things. I'm not afraid of that cannon. Fall. I am standing at the bus terminal with my mom. We are going to visit my grandparents for the weekend. The ride is so long, I'll probably fall asleep. It's very noisy here with all the buses coming in and out. When they are quiet, I can hear the birds and the chirping in the tall trees. The houses here aren't very tall, no high buildings. Sometimes I wish I lived in a house instead of an apartment. My mom's hair shines under the sun. I like holding her hand, and she likes holding mine. At this moment, I forget my fears. Winter. I am laying in bed at my grandparents' house. It's a big house, and it's so cold here. The bed is cold, the floor is cold, the air is cold. My bon mama is tucking me in, but she won't stay long. She's tired. I hate sleeping here on my own. I'm afraid of the silence. Soon, my grandparents will go to bed too. Soon, I will hear my bon papa snoring so loudly that I won't be able to fall asleep. I don't understand how they can sleep. Aren't they afraid? I guess if I hear him snoring, it means that everything is fine and I should stop worrying. Their room is so far and it's so cold. What if someone breaks in? I won't have time to run. They'll find me. Will they come for me or for my grandparents? Maybe they are coming for our neighbors. I wish my mom was here with me. I hold on tight to my doll. Bad things happen at night. Spring. I am sitting on the floor of my grandparents' house. My mom and I came for the weekend. We're watching TV. Bah, they are. I'm playing with my doll. It used to be my mom when she was little. My bon mama made her doll's clothes for her. And my bon papa made her a blue bedroom set out of wood with a bed and a wardrobe. I like changing her clothes and putting her in the little bed to sleep. But that's pretend. When we are going to bed, she sleeps cuddled with me. My grandparents and my mom are watching the news. They are showing lots of people with Argentinian flags on the streets, cars honking. It reminds me of when Argentina wins a soccer match at the World Cup, but this time there are lots more people, I think. My mom combs her hair with her fingers. She seems relieved. My bon mama is tapping her knees with her hands, happily. My bon papa has a big smile under his big mustache and leans forward on his chair to hear what they are saying on TV. People on TV are saying things like, democracy is back, Alfonsín won the elections, the dictatorship is over. I don't understand what that means, but I think I will remember this feeling. I hug my doll. I watch everything. The windows are open. Warm air blows in, rustling the new grape leaves. It is spring.
This is the key. I am standing in the front room of our cozy condominium in Budapest. It is a hot July day. The sharp sunshine just floating into the room from the window front of me. At left of me, a wall of books on shelves, and in the darker shadowed stayed the piano. I slowly watch around. Everything in this room has its own story. How we put together with my husband, step by step. We are going on holiday. I hear my daughter's happy voice outside. She doesn't know we aren't coming back. I'm supposed to go out also, but my legs are frozen. I make myself to remember when they took my husband in the political camp and when he arrived after Then, but 3 years of torture, he wasn't able to walk at first. This memory gave me the energy that I need. I hurry out. I see my daughter and my husband waiting for me. My daughter has a little backpack, a teddy bear in it, its head sticking out carefully so it can breathe. Beside my husband are two suitcases. We have packed only enough summer clothes for a short vacation. My husband has the passport and only as much money as the government will let us to take with us for 10 days vacation. I watch them, my daughter and my husband. Let's go, Mom, my daughter tells very excitement, with big excitement. She has no future here, I heard my husband said, smiling voice. Oh, yes. I force myself to turn back, and finally, I lock the door. It happened almost 40 years ago, but I have this key even now. It means memory of my life at home and has a great, deep meaning of freedom.
Your education shapes you. The daily struggles, making friends, each step has its quirks. Now throw in constant change and country hopping, and you've entered a whole new ballgame. Like most kids of my generation from the Arab world, we got the chance to experience life, and of course the education system, not only in the countries of our origin, but the countries of our birth, and for a lucky few, a taste of the West. My journey begins when we leave Saudi Arabia for Houston, Texas. I'm in preschool and Mom cannot walk me to the bus stop. I'm determined to do it on my own. There's a small catch though. She has to stand on the porch, blowing kisses and waving goodbye until the bus turns the corner or I'll have an epic meltdown. The bus supervisor's words, not mine. At my preschool graduation, I keep inviting everyone over as if I'm the only one graduating that day. I'm pumped for the next school year. We don't end up staying though. It's time to move back to Lebanon. We're finally home, I remember my mom saying. Lebanon was in the midst of a civil war, the on years. And school, for the lack of a better word, was interesting. We ride to school in small vans and go through a number of armed checkpoints between our home and school. It's a hit or miss if they'll let us pass. The American Community School of Beirut overlooks the Mediterranean Sea. By contrast, the field next door houses an army base, which was attacked one day when I was in school. Two grade one classes are crammed into the corner of one classroom. Gunfire can be heard flying overhead. Teachers plead with us to keep our voices down. But really, how calm can you keep 6 and 7 year olds when it feels like the world is ending? I'm in the first row of kids, so I stand up to see what's happening. There's a big window facing the corniche, and I can see people running and some falling to the ground. What's that expression again? Out of the frying pan and into the fire? We escaped one armed conflict only to find ourselves in another. You have to laugh at the irony. It's 1990, we're now in Saudi and Iraq invades Kuwait. We've been issued gas masks and are required to carry them with us at all times, even to school. Our school, that typically has 2,000 students, is down to 500, perhaps less. All non-Arab students have fled the country. The rest of us can't go back home. It's safer for us to live out this conflict than the ones our native countries are going through. There's definitely an upside though. I met a second cousin I never knew I had. A few friends have similar experiences. 4 years later, we're back in Beirut. Can you see the pattern? A I finished off my high school and undergraduate years in Lebanon, itching for the next adventure. Opportunity strikes, and I make my way to Scotland to continue my graduate degree, but not without my mom finding someone she befriends to keep me safe. You see, I'm the baby, and I have a medical condition that worries my mother to this day. Deep down, I was hoping I'd be completely on my own like my sister got to be when she went. Turns out though, mom was right. Don't tell her I said that. If you do, I'll deny it. One day, things got really bad and my roommates called an ambulance. I was taken to the hospital and got admitted for observation. A couple of days later, auntie came and got me. I recuperated at her place for a week. Moms are always right. We fight them on things, but damn it, they're always right. You see, this was the plan. Move to Canada with my new husband and continue my PhD. But oddly enough, my UK degree is not recognized and I opt for a second master's. I spend hours driving back and forth to Hamilton. In the end, I didn't hit that goal, but I achieved one that was so much sweeter. We end up having three kids back to back. They are now our focus. For them, stability is key. We haven't moved since my arrival in 2007. Canada is their home, Kitchener in particular. But for me, everywhere and nowhere feels like home. One thing I know for certain, home is where my family happens to be.
We awaken before the sun is up because her day starts much earlier than mine. Today, I am being taken to my mother's workplace to experience a full day of work for the first time. My friends will be sitting in air-conditioned offices and lively storefronts to help their parents. Not me, no. I'm going right to the front lines of the car parts factory that my mother goes to every single day. My mother is already dressed, pants pressed, and shirt tucked. She's downstairs filling her lunch container with steamed rice, some preserved Chinese sausage, and a side of veggies left over from yesterday's dinner. She's fast and efficient and growing more annoyed with me by the minute as I drag my feet. I hurry down the stairs and we hop into the Mazda MPV that makes whirring sounds when it shouldn't. Her focus is on the road ahead, making sure that she arrives at work on time in order to park at the special parking spot by the back door of the factory so that she can leave the barracks easily at the end of the day to go home. We park to the side of the building, but enter through the front. I'm a special guest, she says, so I must sign in at the office. She leaves me to get into her uniform and I'm given my own uniform, a blue overcoat, steel-toed boots, safety glasses, and a hard hat. I am my mother's younger self, just a trainee and not quite high enough in the ranks to get a uniform adorned with my own embroidered name badge. A buzzer goes off in the distance, and my mother hurries me onto the factory floor. And I'm immediately assaulted by the sounds of the big machines hissing and stomping, whirring and squealing. My mother maneuvers across the floor with ease, leading the way as I follow behind, holding onto my hat and asking questions about the schedule for the day. At her station, she finds me a hard plastic chair and places it behind her in the farthest corner. Her station includes three large machines that form a U around a central worker. Each machine has a function. One cuts, one measures, and one buffs. 2,000 per day. My mother takes her place in the middle of these machines, and when she turns them on, my senses are immediately insulted again. The pungent smell of gasoline and metals infuse my nostrils and cause my eyes to water. I am relieved when the buzzer goes off again to indicate that it's time for lunch. At lunch, my mother takes me to the locker room where she opens her locker door. And I see the pictures that have been missing from family albums for years, hanging all over the inside of her door. I am shocked and equally embarrassed that there are so many photos of myself and my siblings, ranging from when we were toddlers until present-day teenagers. I wonder why she has these photos in her locker when she sees us every day. When she takes out her lunch bag, I'm surprised to see that she hasn't packed me lunch. Instead, she treats me to a can of chunky soup from the food truck at the back of the factory. We head back into the lunchroom where my mother heats up her rice. I'm overcome with gratitude for the treat, but also with tremendous guilt that my mother, yet again, is not eating the same meal with me. When lunch is over, the buzzer goes off and we are back onto the factory floor. But this time, I watch my mother as she operates these big machines while I sit 8 feet away, completely protected in gear. I notice that her blue uniform is adorned with floral patterns of oil and dirt, and her hair, burnt and dried from her home perm, is hidden underneath her hard hat. In her hands, which often enjoy the weight of a pen, are covered with gloves that are far too big for her child-sized hands. She stands with her back to me like a soldier, stiff and at attention, guarding me from the fumes and oils of these big machines. This has been her post for the past 10 years, and it dawns on me that those photos in her locker are simply her reasons why. What I learn on that day at this dirty car parts factory, books could never teach me.
This is Nazmi, who came to Canada in 2014 with my small family of five, me, my husband, two daughters, and mother-in-law. My mother-in-law was dear to my heart. Her warm hugs and kisses were the source of my happiness. The best food and clothes she saved for me. When I was sick, her tender words overwhelmed me and filled my heart with love. I called her mama, because I felt that I was her daughter. She called me by the special name, Nona Nona. We fled the war in Libya, fearing for our lives. When we arrived in Canada, I felt relaxed and happy after feeling fear for my family. Within a short time after moving to Ottawa, Mama began to feel sick. The situation was getting worse every day, and it was difficult to know the reason. Moving from one hospital to another, the white paper and the pen were the two friends who came with me to doctors. And in the same paper, receiving answers from them to help me understand the situation when returning home. One night, we were watching TV in the living room at 12 o'clock. I tried to wake up Mama to take her to bed. I could see her eyes saying Nona, but she wasn't able to move her mouth. I ran. I woke up my husband, wake up, wake up. And he called an ambulance. When I heard the knocking at 12:30 a.m., I opened the door. And the surprise was that they were carrying a lot of things and the stretcher. My heart was beating a lot, fearing for her and for my husband, especially since he was her only son. Mama needed surgery. I was fearful, and I was relieved the operation was successful. Our family moved to Waterloo for my husband's school. I found myself living in the midst of wonderful community. The chemotherapy sessions were passing peaceful, and still the paper and the pen, the best friend to me on every visit to the hospital. I played the role of nurse in caring for mama. I studied to be a nurse back in Libya, but I could not finish the course like a nurse. I had to withdraw the water from her body, changing her bandage, and cleaning the wound. I cared for mama for 4 years. They saved the family money while my husband was studying, and I was also learning language in a new way. After the doctor's report that she was in her last day, it was difficult to feel comfortable. Even my daughters, age 9 and 10, preferred to stay with her at home instead of going out or playing in the park. The first question when we had a plan to go out was, is grandma coming with us? If the answer was yes, that meant the best day. But if the answer was no, the plan had to cancel. One night at 3 a.m., I went to help her go to the bathroom like every night at this time. I did not hear her voice call me like she always did. My husband woke up to check her, and he asked me to turn the light on. My eyes were looking to her face. Her face was like an angel with a smile. I kissed her. I felt her cold hands. I heard my husband saying, "Mama, mama, wake up, wake up." But we did not hear any response. Over now, at 3 a.m., the voice of that lady still echoes in my ears. "Nuna, Nuna, love you, mom."
I'm a pregnant woman, expecting to deliver my twins next Monday. I had told my doctor I wanted my second baby to be a natural birth. My pregnancy is a result of an in vitro process, and because it would be twins, my doctor said that I probably couldn't go through with a natural birth. Today is Saturday, it's 8 p.m., and I'm in the doctor's clinic. The ultrasound has shown that that baby's heads are up, which means for sure I couldn't have a natural birth. It's my doctor's opinion that I have to have a cesarean on Monday at 7 a.m. I prepare a bag for the hospital. I'm waiting for the day because being pregnant with the twins is not easy, especially in the last few weeks. I'm sleeping and suddenly feel cold and ask my husband to give me an extra blanket. It's 5 a.m. I want to pray Al-Fajr. It's the first of Muslims' 5 prayers. During my prayers, waters come out after a strong cough. I'm shocked and understand this is a sign of labor. There's no pain and no labor contractions. I call the doctor. He tells me he has to deliver the babies today. He asks about contractions, but there aren't any. This is not my first baby, so I know the feel of soft contractions. The doctor tells me to go to the hospital at 7 a.m. I have a quick shower, then I start feeling the contractions. The pain is increasing. Things are going so fast. Suddenly, there's some blood. I call the doctor again to let him know about the severe pain. "You will deliver your twins soon," he told me. "Come to the hospital as fast as you can." I can't dress up my pants, so I put on a skirt. I can't stop myself from yelling because the pain is unbelievable. It's early and my yelling has awakened my neighbor. I walk to our car. These are the hardest steps in my life. My husband asks me to sit in the front seat, but I can't. So he helps me to lay on in the back seat. It's almost 6 a.m. The streets are empty, so my husband drives fast, 160 kilometers per hour. I feel that I can't hear or see anything because of the pain. After 3 minutes, I tell him to slow down because our first baby is here. He is shocked. He tells me that I'm tired, that I'm imagining I've delivered the baby. Then we hear our baby crying. He barks on the side of the street and looks at me with astonishment. Both of us are lost and wondering what to do. I realize I have to wrap the baby. I ask my husband to bring a towel from the bag that we packed for the hospital. He realizes that he forgot it in front of our home. It's still in the parking lot. Now I'm thinking of how to have a clean place for my first baby. My husband takes off his shirt and wraps my baby with it. The baby is laying on the back seat in his father's shirt. I can feel his warmth as I hold his head with my hand. I feel better with less pain. But the second baby is still in my womb. My husband continues driving fast. I call the doctor to let him know what's happening. I ask my husband where we are because the other baby is almost here. My husband tells me that in 2 minutes, we will be in the hospital. We arrive, the nurses, patient stretchers are there in front of the hospital. My husband tells them we can't move now because the other baby is on his way. The doctor realizes that the other baby needs to be out as soon as possible. The second baby doesn't come from his head, and the doctor acts quickly and takes him out of the womb. Within 2 minutes, my second baby is born, and the doctor cuts the umbilical cord. Then he cuts the umbilical cord for the first baby. Then he took out the placenta. Then I entered the hospital after my twins. I wanted a natural birth, but not this one. My twins, Faris and Mohammed, are 10 years old now. Thank you.
Hero.
Missing.
Glasses.
Baba.
Love.
Christmas goat.
Lulu.
Little things.
Smile.
Love.
Doll.
Freedom.
Family.
Mom.
Nuna.
Hope.
Joy.
Community.
Sisterhood.
Honored.
Harmony.
Welcome.
Wonder.
Inspired.
Storytelling.
Little things.
Ooh, 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 ooh.
sala abhi abhi hua yakin ki aag hai mujh mein kahin